Yeah, actually, that's a very subtle question. It's sort of the balance between bringing, calling back, calling to mind the truth of unity and all perfection and all completion, like Ra says, higher self, complete and whole and perfect. Calling to mind that reality as a practice. As a way of being versus thought-based self-investigation, psychological self-understanding, thinking through, talking through emotional personal process. Would you say that that is similar? That's one summary of your question. Well, I think that both need to be done as, you know, as needed. PRN, as a doctor's prescription might say, in the sense that when we have a problem, I think it's good to apply the thought-based process. You see, I've said this a few times in lectures before. The guy named Ray Vespe, Vespe, who was the counseling director at CIIS, one of the integral counseling centers that where I did internship in the late 80s, early 90s. He said, if you can't see through it, you have to see it through. If you can't see through it means if you cannot see its emptiness, you need to see it through by thinking and usually talking out the specifics of the psychological process, or you know, causality, and you know, ramifications and causes and effects, and acknowledging deeper meaning, and moving out of those distortions by thought, versus being able to see things are empty, which is akin to realizing the big view in a moment. That all is complete and whole and perfect. When there's a problem, we have to address it honestly to really solve it. To really solve it, we have to really address issues frankly, honestly, without avoiding. How's the best way to do that? Well, I think it depends on the issue, depends on the person, depends on their level of development, depends on any specific process. So I wouldn't say one is better than the other. As one goes on further, it's easier to see the emptiness of problematics. It's also easier to dwell naturally in the awareness of complete and whole and perfect. Some people use that as a kind of spiritual bypass. Obviously, that's not a good. That's not honest, actually. You know. Somebody has a problem and they're upset about it, and then they say, well, you know, everything's complete and everything's perfect anyway. But actually, they're still upset, and they haven't discovered roots to it. The roots are still implanted. And just saying it's perfect doesn't help, actually, even though it's a form of avoidance then. So, Ra talked about those four practices: look in the mirror, see the creator, look around you at objects, and look around at people also. One, two, three, see the creator, and then the moment contains love. That's sort of making a practice of absolute view, right? There's the two views, relative and absolute. The relative is where we do the personal working of psychological self-analysis or thinking things through. Seeing it through, or you know, seeing it through. The absolute view is associated with seeing emptiness or seeing perfection, which go both ways, or it's really two sides of the same absolute view. Non-duality, impersonal, transpersonal. And it's just critical not to get stuck in the personal and not to use the transpersonal as a means of avoidance. And so long as we're not doing that, I think one can let one's mind be free and go whichever way it seems right at the moment. So not getting stuck in the personal and not avoiding it by sort of a little bit of a dishonest use of the transpersonal or the absolute. Or, you know, is it safe to walk around feeling things are fine? Well, it's fine to be in that way, it seems to me. So long as it doesn't become a trance. You know, so there's the link into the two forms of meditation in Buddhism, vipassana or shamatha and vipassana, or vipassana mindfulness that leads to moment-to-moment awareness and response ability, the ability to have a real-time, clear, or love, wisdom, balance response in the moment, versus shamatha, samadhi, which goes to the jhanas, which is a trance, which is where people basically get attached to blissful states. Blissful states is akin to absolute view, or absolute view is the conceptual interpretation or conceptual explanation of jhanic states or trance states or blissful states. When, you know, it's like if you're walking down the street and a old lady or a child falls down in front of you, and you're attached to a jhanic state, or you're in, everything's fine, good. What are you going to do? Walk by and say, you know, have a good day, and let them lie in the street? No, you would pick them up. But if you're too much stuck in, you know, if you're attached to that blissful state, or unity, or non-dual, you know, a non-dual condition, then you might avoid responsibility. So I think it's a matter of being natural, trusting yourself, trusting your process, acknowledging that being attached to either the analysis of personal process, which is people who are always thinking about themselves, thinking about their process, versus attachment to blissful, you know, samadhi states, non-dual states, even walking around. Both attachment both ways is no good, or is, you know, of limited value. It's okay to be, you know, sometimes attachment is necessary, so long as the person gets out of it eventually. But walking around in the world, if one is well, one is well. It's great. But I think one should never forget, one should not close the heart or cut off from the reality of the collective around us in some sense, if one's there. Yes, spiritual bypass in that case, I think would be, you know, whenever there's an avoidance of the personal, physical, material, conceptual, interpersonal, social, emotional, you know, anything below below the diaphragm, you can say that avoidance of catalysts associated with lower triad dynamics, whether there's blockage or not, avoidance in any way of anything, any experience in body-mind, including interpersonally associated with lower triad, closely associated with 3D space-time, particularly body-mind, is spiritual bypass. On the other hand, walking around thinking of the starving people in Africa or thinking about all the suffering in the world is itself a form of an attachment. And so, you know, I remember I once got very deeply connected to the suffering of humanity. I mean, more than normal, and felt it very, very viscerally, and had a sense that how could I ever be happy in this world where there's so much suffering ongoing 24/7? And I never answered it, but the state changed, and I didn't stop the change, which means I didn't, you know, I wasn't paralyzed by grief after a time, and it's I think that there's nothing wrong with that. So long as one is centered, or one wishes to keep open heart or keep heart sensitivity. There's a phrase, there's a, in 89.29 from the raw material, the what I was looking for was something related to this dynamic of where to pay attention, where to focus, or the proper direction of attention as a general principle. And Ra, Don asked, what was the attitude just prior to harvest of those harvestable entities of Ra with respect to those who are obviously unharvestable, meaning those on their own planet, I believe, who were not harvestable because they got stuck in certain ways? And Ra said, those of us which had the gift of polarity, this is 8929, those of us which have the gift of polarity, meaning positively oriented, felt deep compassion for those who seemed to dwell in darkness. This description is most apt, as ours was a harshly bright planet in the physical sense. There was every attempt made to reach out with whatever seemed to be needed, and that's the real principle of non-interfering service, is making attempt or any attempt to offer what seems to be needed. Not what I want to give necessarily, but what seems to be needed that I can give. And then the critical line here is they said, however, those upon the positive path have the comfort of companions, and we of Ra spent a great deal of our attention upon the possibilities of achieving spiritual or metaphysical adepthood or work in Indigo Ray through the means of relationship with other selves. Consequently, compassion for those in darkness was balanced by appreciation of the light. That's the kind of balance, that's a higher triad balance. Higher triad blockage, a higher triad balance, where higher triad here means 4, 5, 6. There are other ways of looking at it also. You could say that 5, 6, 7 is also higher. But the balance is looking down and looking in, or looking out to those in suffering and looking around to one's companions in joy, or in love, or in community. And when the need, you know, when an opportunity for service comes, we can meet it if we're really balanced and well. When it doesn't, we don't. Rushing out to find those that are suffering to try to help them in this world may be fine, so long as that seems to be natural, right action for that person. So I think that there's no one-size-fits-all formula other than the principles of balance and heart open, you know, heart sensitivity and moment-to-moment awareness or moment-to-moment sensitivity to the needs of the situation and being true to one's own way. And putting all that together, hopefully one stays balanced, or one, you know, at least knows what some kind of return to balance could be. And that attempting to stay in balance, or attempting to return to balance, attempting to be present and be responsible to catalyst as necessary. It's all very subtle, I think. But I think it also depends on, you know, where one's come, one knowing motivations. Like in any relationship, part of what nixes or makes big trouble in relationship between wanderers and those who are not, or people who are spiritually oriented and those who are not, when they finally discover that, is that their motivations for being together are not the same. One may be seeking safety, security, and or material support, and the other one may be seeking deep communication for mutual personal growth. And there are then limits to those, or each the degrees to which each person is seeking deep communication and mutual personal growth. The degrees may be different and not compatible sometimes, obviously. So, I think the thing is, when you're well, be well. And when it changes, be there too. And when somebody in suffering appears to us, get a sense of where they're coming from and what seems to be needed. What seemed to be needed is a very nice way of putting it, as Ra did. So I think all that all of that is walking open-handed and when we're attached, the fist is clenched, the hand is clenched to a fist, we're holding. When we're holding, we can't receive. And open hand walking, you know, walking in the world open-handed, is hands available for linking with others, and not being attached to our own state, whether it's, you know, distorted or non-dual, apparently non-dual. Yeah, I mean, psychological process should be given its due. You know, give to Caesar what's due to Caesar. Meaning, give to the personal mind or the specifics of an interpersonal situation what seems to be due or appropriate, what seems to be needed. And sometimes that means thinking real deeply, like, what's wrong with me? what's the basis of my strong emotional reaction? What's this all about? And thinking it out, or speaking it out. And then other times, the mind is well, and there's no need to do anything to that either. Some people can't be well with that. So there is some kind of deep trust, self-trusting involved in being sensitive to the right, you know, right use of attention, to the right, to proper direction of attention, because that's what we're talking about here. So it's like, in meditation, that's actually a training ground for that, or vipassana practice. Mindfulness is, lots of stuff comes up in mind-body that's unimportant. One can note it and go back to the breath. Yet sometimes process, particularly thought and feeling, comes up, memory, that we naturally take note of and get, quote, stuck on, but it often is useful to think it through. Like, what's going on here? Like any kind of body symptomology. You can say it's all fine, but it'd be helpful to understand it too, particularly if it persists and is disturbing. So it's being centered, being grounded, being honest, being real, not faking, not avoiding, not running away, not playing little games in the mind. That kind of attitude, I think, is what leads to right focus and right response in general. So, but thank you so much. Take good care of yourselves. See you next week. Okay, good night.